So now staging of neck node metastasis. NX, as we all know, is regional nodes which cannot be assessed. N0 is no metastasis. N1 is single ipsilateral node, which is less than 3 cm, as we all know. 2A, 2B, and 2C. 2A is single ipsilateral node, 3 to 6 cm. 2B is multiple ipsilateral, but on the same side, less than 6 or 6. And 2C says that it is bilateral or contralateral nodes, 6 or more than less than 6. And if it is, any node anywhere more than 6 is N3, 6 cm. Now, all the tumors go according to this staging, but the nasopharyngeal tumor goes according to host staging, which I don't think the surgeons would like it. I mean, they need it. And the staging in thyroid cancer has two types of neck nodes: N1A, which is ipsilateral neck nodes, any size; N1B is goes to the other side or is in the midline or bilateral. This is N1B. Now, classification of neck dissection. Academics classification. Academy has classified this into radical neck dissection, modified radical neck dissection, selective neck dissection. Selective neck dissection is, radical neck dissection is dissection of the nodes from the unilateral side of the neck, as we have stated, from the lower border of the mandible up to the clavicle, okay, of the same side, and posteriorly up to the anterior border of the trapezius muscle, anteriorly to the lateral border of the sternohyoid muscle. And modified neck dissection is, we modify it. It's also known as functional neck dissection, where we preserve the sternocleidomastoid, intertubular vein, or the accessory nerve, spinal accessory nerve. Now, selective neck dissection, also known as elective neck dissection, is, number one is supraomohyoid neck dissection, where we remove 1, 2, and 3 group of lymph nodes. Lateral neck dissection, where we remove 2, 3, and 4. Posterior lateral, we remove 2, 3, 4, 5. And occasionally posterior orbital and suboccipital. Anterior or central compartment clearance, level 6, which is done in thyroid cancers. And we have to do it if there is a thyroid cancer. And extended radical neck dissection is, besides the lymphatic structures, we remove the carotid artery sometimes, parotid sometimes, hypoglossal nerve sometimes if it's involved. So this is the radical, extended radical neck dissection. Nowadays, we would not like to classify as selective neck dissection. We would like to say the lymph nodes of the levels removed. Like for supraomohyoid, we would say neck dissection level 1 to 3, not supraomohyoid. Right? So it will be much more clearer. So I've said about this. Medina's classification is comprehensive neck dissection and selective neck dissection. Comprehensive is radical neck dissection and modified radical neck dissection. As I've said, if you preserve only the spinal accessory nerve, it is type 1. If you preserve spinal accessory and the intertubular vein, then it's type 2. If you preserve all the three, that is sternocleidomastoid, intertubular, and the spinal accessory, then it is type 3 or functional neck dissection and selective neck dissection, as I've already said. Now, there is fibrous classification as well. I don't think we have to go through this. Now, another is end block dissection. It is always better to remove the neck node in end block along with the cancer cells, okay? Like that is removal of the primary malignancy in continuity with the neck dissection. This is preferred technique for every cancer, but like in oral cavity, tongue cancers, etc., we will not be able to do so. So we remove in disjunction. Therapeutic light is done in palpable nose, which is very rare nowadays in papillary carcinomas. Very picking was done in ancient times, not nowadays. Elective or prophylactic is done for impalpable nodes in cases of more than 25% risk of open neck node metastasis. Especially we ENT surgeons would not like to leave the neck nodes if there is a cancer in the tongue. Okay? Planning of neck incision, this is very important. Provided we provide adequate exposure to primary malignancies and targeted lymph nodes, the incision or the area to be operated should provide adequate blood supply to the neck flap. Curvilinear incision is better than a straight cut incisions. Minimize the use of trifurcate incisions. This is very important because there will be necrosis and wound gaping. Even there will be suffering in that area if you use trifurcate incisions. Avoid trifurcations over the carotid artery because it would lead to carotid blowout if there is infection or metastasis. Avoid vital structures underneath the neck dissection. Now, some of the important neck dissection incisions are apron incision. Half apron incision. Then we have the Conley incision, and we have the double Y incision. We have H-shaped incision, McPhee incision is double parallel line incision. This incision is very important where there is irradiated neck. Okay, if you have irradiation of the neck before surgery, we have to perform McPhee incision. This is the best one because there are no triradiate points anywhere. Then modified Schrödinger incision and Schrödinger incision. Then other incisions are horizontal utility, lateral utility, visor, extended thyroid, Boomerang incisions. Now, the radical neck dissection proper. About the radical neck dissection, the boundaries of the radical neck dissection, I've already said, it is from the superior border is from the inferior border of the mandible to the clavicle inferiorly, posteriorly anterior border of the trapezius, and anteriorly the opposite to the anterior belly of the digastric. So, and then the thyroid cartilage, and then the lateral border, lateral border of the sternohyoid. So, not in the midline, please remember. Okay. So, the structures removed in radical neck dissection is level 1 to level 5 lymph nodes, spinal accessory nerve is removed, sternocleidomastoid and omohyoid are the two muscles which we remove, internal jugular vein and the external jugular vein, sensory branches of the cervical plexus, which is again an important structure here. Some mandibular salivary gland is removed, but the parotid is not removed. Only the tail of the parotid gland is removed. If you remove the parotid, it goes into extended radical neck dissection. And about the indications, why do we have to do the radical neck dissection is, if there is extensive cervical involvement or matted lymph nodes with gross extracapsular spread and invasion into the accessory nerve, and the internal jugular vein and the sternocleidomastoid, or there is recurrence of the disease after surgery, after radiotherapy, chemotherapy, or a combination, then we would like to go for radical neck dissection. Okay? About the contraindications of radical neck dissection, uncontrolled, untreatable primary malignancy, no use of radical neck dissection. Evidence of distant metastasis, no use of radical neck dissection. Inoperable neck masses, that is, if there is mass fixed to the carotid artery, then radical will not be enough. We have to go to extended radical neck dissection. If it's mass is fixed to the cervical spine, vagus nerve, brachial plexus, cervical sympathetic chain, then radical neck dissection is not enough. If the life expectancy is very less, if the patient is unfit for major surgeries, then these are the contraindications for radical neck dissection. About the modified radical neck dissection, okay? Modified radical is radical neck dissection, but it is modified in order to maintain the function. So, the extension is the same, but the structures removed are in type 1, the accessory nerve is preserved. Type 2, accessory nerve and the intertubular vein is preserved. And in type 3, all the three are preserved, known as functional neck dissection. Type 3, modified radical, is also known as functional neck dissection. This, the rationale of putting these structures in place is, it reduces the post-surgical shoulder pain and shoulder dysfunction because spinal accessory helps in the shoulder movement. We all know that. Proved cosmetic outcome because the sternocleidomastoid improves upon the neck contour. It reduces the likelihood of bilateral jugular vein resection and then contralateral neck involvement. As we know that inter-jugular vein resection bilaterally is very difficult because patient will have lots of complications. So now type 1, as we have said, is the this is preservation of the spinal accessory nerve. Type 2 is the spinal accessory as well as the internal jugular vein. And type 3 is even the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Now about the selective neck dissection. Selective neck dissection is preferred type of neck dissection nowadays, and we say it is the dissection of level 1 to 3, 3 to 4 rather than selective. This is cervical lymph adenectomy with preservation of one or more lymph node groups. Four common subtypes are there, as I have already said. Supraomohyoid neck dissection. Supraomohyoid selective neck dissection boundaries are superiorly have, we have already said it is the dissection of level 1, 2, 3 and 1, 2 and 3. Okay? So inferior border of the mandible, junction of omohyoid muscle with the internal jugular vein. In supramohyoid dissection, we reach to the junction of the internal jugular vein and the omohyoid. This is the low extension of the supramohyoid dissection. Posterior border is again the same, the sternum with the mastoid and the gluteal branches of the cervical plexus, and then anteriorly opposite anterior digastric hyoid bone and lateral border of the omohyoid muscle. This is the supra-omohyoid dissection. So this is in the anterior triangle, but not reaching the midline again and not going below the level where the omohyoid crosses the internal jugular vein. So this is supra-omohyoid dissection. This is the dissection very favored by the ENT surgeons when we see the tongue tumor or oropharyngeal tumors. Now, indications is oral cavity, squamous cell carcinoma, T2 to T4, N0, M0, or T1, T4 tumors, N1, M0, or bilateral neck dissection for anterior midline or floor of the mouth cancers. In midline cancer, we do bilateral SOND. Now, we go to lateral selective neck dissection. Lateral, just the lateral part, that is the second, third, and the fourth, just below the sternocleidomastoid muscle, that is around the jugular vein. So it is end block removal of the jugular lymph nodes, that is lateral neck dissection, level 2, 3 and 4. We've already seen here the levels 2, 3 and 4 indications are N0 neck nodes in carcinoma of the oropharynx, hypopharynx and even supraglottic carcinomas. We have to, the lymph nodes that drain is in the lateral group of lymph nodes. So we do lateral selective or lymph node level 2, 3 and 4 dissection. Okay, this is bilateral selective neck node dissection done for CA of the tongue, carcinoma of the tongue. Okay, posterior lateral neck dissection now. Posterior lateral is the lateral group. Posterior lateral is the posterior group of lymph nodes as well as the lateral group of lymph nodes. That is end block excision of the nodes 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, suboccipital and posterior auricular nodes. Indications are nodal metastasis in the scalp, malignancies, melanomas, etc. So this is the picture of the melanoma. And we have done the posterior lateral dissection. Central compartment dissection is from the hyoid bone above to the supraspinal notch below, and uncarotid sheets laterally. Structures removed are ipsilateral thyroid lobe, level 4. Lymph node, perithyroidal, pericricoid, that is delphins, and paratracheal lymph nodes are removed. This is done for thyroid cancers. Indication papillary follicular thyroid carcinoma, parathyroid carcinoma, subglottic carcinoma, laryngeal carcinoma, etc. And then carcinoma of the cervical esophagus. Now, extended neck dissection is left. Definition is any previous dissection with any other added structures, like we can add, as I've already said, carotid artery, like the hypoglossal nerve or the parotids, etc. So indications are carotid artery invasion, others are hypoglossal nerve, mediastinal lymph nodes are removed, or thyroid nerve removal. Contraindications are intracranial spread of cancer, extensive erosion of the bony skull base, lateral walls, sphenoid, cavernous sinus, marmony, goivany. We don't do even extended lateral extended dissection. Now, this is a mediastinal neck node dissection, which we surgeons do not know. We ENT surgeons, we don't perform. This is done by the general surgeons. It is just to give you the like picture. Approach to the superior mediastinum is by this route, by removing the external. And superior mediastinal dissection is done, and then we repair it by pectoralis major, myocutaneous flap. Okay? Now, complications. Last but not the least, hemorrhage. As we know, carotid artery hemorrhage, clamp and suture, CTBS surgery should be called if there is carotid artery hemorrhage, jugular vein hemorrhage, that is not very difficult. We plicate it with the posterior leg of the digastric, and carotid sinus reflex. While dissecting around the carotid bifurcation, patient may have hypotension. We have to be careful while fiddling around it. Pneumothorax, surgeons can do a chest drain. Air embolism, when large veins are opened, clinically patients have sinus hypotension, and then peripheral pulses will disappear. We have to be careful in cases of air embolism. And post-operative complications like hematoma, suction drain should be always applied, wound infection, skin flap loss or necrosis, salivary fistula, because we have removed the tail of the parotid initially, and chylus fistula is very important. Around 75% of the chylus fistula is from the left side of the neck. And in chylus fistula, if it is less than 600 ml of fluid, then we have to replace the fluid. We have to correct the electrolytes, Patient will have hyponatremia, hypochloremia, and then we have hypoproteinemia. Yeah? So we have to give fluids and we have to give parenteral medium chain lipoproteins also. And if the patient has more than 600 of ml of this chylocerin, which is whitish milky substance coming out, yeah? Then we have to give 50% fat. And then we have to put the patient in Trendelenburg position, increase the intraabdominal pressure, we see the leak and repair it for 4-0 proline. Okay? And then facial edema, as we have seen in this picture, this facial edema, this is because of the ligation of the bilateral jugular, intertubular vein, which is very, very difficult for the patient. This is known as purple pumpkin appearance. We have to put the patient in head up position, and then we have to decrease the amount of fluid given to the patient, give dexamethasone, and please avoid ligating bilateral intertubular veins as far as possible. Easily said, but difficult to do that. Seroma, platelet electrolyte imbalances, carotid artery rupture can also be present. We call the CTVS. And late complications, recurrence, primary, nodal, distant, and in thyroid or parathyroid failure, parotid tail hypertrophy can be seen as a complication. Lymph edema, hypertrophic scar, keloid, wound healing after radiation therapy, wound infection, fistula flap necrosis, and even osteoradio necrosis. Thank you.